Hello and welcome back to the Healthcare Uncomplicated YouTube channel. Before I go ahead with another fantastic episode for you, make sure you subscribe to the channel, also share the amazing previous content there with your communities in healthcare, life sciences, and pharma. And today gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Anna Erat. She's a medical director at the Longevity Center in Europe. She's also a speaker, a mentor, and a board member. Anna, how are you?
I'm really well, thank you so much. I'm absolutely honored to be here today, João. So thank you for having me.
No, thank you for accepting my invite. And we are here to discuss a very exciting topic, longevity and the importance of preventive health. And the first question that I have for you is, what advancements in personalized medicine all the potential to revolutionize preventive health strategies?
So in the past years, quite a lot has happened. I suppose when we talk about personalized medicine, a lot of us think about genetics, which is right. But of course, there are other ways to also personalize personalized medicine altogether. In terms of genetics, I think a lot has happened since 2000 when we, the first time, were able to determine the human genome. It's only 23 years ago that Craig Venter and the Human Genome Project managed to do that. And ever since, there have been so many developments. Nowadays, we can really determine crucial genes that might be a predisposition for certain diseases and disorders, but also genes that might be able to improve your health. So not only leading to disease, but only to also to optimize your regime, your exercise regime, your diet, and so forth. What we call more kind of lifestyle genes. That's also something that we nowadays really can determine at a cost that's far away from what it was 20 or 24 years ago now, very, very soon. So a lot has happened in terms of the genes, which we then use for personalized medicine. But there are a lot of other things also in terms of epigenetics that we can do to personalize therapies, treatments, and optimize our health.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Anna. Moving on, in the realm of preventive health, what emerging technologies or scientific advancements show promise in extending human longevity?
Well, I think what everyone has in mind at the moment is artificial intelligence. So, of course, to use technology, including artificial intelligence, for certain algorithms will and has already revolutionized medicine. But that's just really one aspect. Also, monitoring, real-life reporting, in terms of using gadgets, in terms of using aura rings, in terms of using wearables, shirts that can measure your heart rate variability and also your heart function or function as an ECG, has potentially a huge impact on optimizing health and performance, and also when we are sick, also to report quickly in real time to the doctors that are treating you, so that there is no lag, time lag in the reporting and also in changing therapy if needed. So there are quite a lot of new technology in place. Do you have a specific question in mind? You know, because it's such a vast field. So,
yeah, I don't have a specific question in mind, but it was great that you highlighted what is more prominent right now: the wearables, the innovation around sensing technologies, of course, artificial intelligence. And I wrote an article for a book a few years ago, and my vision was the combination of artificial intelligence and wearables would be the game changer. Unfortunately, wearables are moving slowly for some reason in healthcare and life sciences, but definitely things are happening now. I was talking to a pharma client this morning, and things are actually happening right now. How do you see it, Anne?
Well, yes, I mean, wearables, when we talk about lifestyle wearables and also performance enhancing wearables, that's where we are moving quite fast. But as soon as we go into to medical devices, that's where we have some stumbling blocks, so to speak. And in a way, it makes sense because, of course, whatever is medical, any medical device or any medical therapeutic for that matter, of course, has to go through a very thorough process through in the US through the FDA, in other countries through other health authorities to be then allowed to enter the market. And of course, it makes sense, but it shouldn't be a reason why the development is hindered or artificially made too slow or very slow. But again, as soon as we enter into medical devices, the development speed or the speed of development will per default be lowered. So having said that, a lot of what we call lifestyle devices, they develop at the light of speed, the speed of light. So I think we can learn a lot from that field, even if we don't enter into the medical devices.
Absolutely. You know, I'm an advocate of wearables. I like the Oura Ring and also other wearables. I've been playing with wearables for quite a long time. And they're certainly very promising. And I like that distinguisher out. Of course, the life science and then the medical side is a different ballgame altogether. And then moving on, how can personalized medicine be made more accessible to diverse populations in public health efforts, ensuring everyone benefits and achieve longevity?
Well, they have to be embedded in the entire medical system. So just if you have one kit that analyzes some parts of your DNA and your genomics, that still doesn't enable for you to really profit properly and get benefit from personalized medicine. So it has to be embedded in an entire medical system. And I think here, in order to make it more accessible, we also need to use technology. So the traditional method or the traditional model is to always go to your GP, which has been your GP for 20 or 30 years, which is not bad. Actually, there's a lot of benefit knowing the person and the GP having known you from birth until you got married and until you got divorced or whatnot. So that has a lot of benefit. But on the other hand, when we want to scale and really reach a bigger population and really do it in a fairly quick and responsible time frame, we need to use technology and digital tools. And I think that the COVID pandemic, with all the negative aspects of the pandemic, without a doubt, one positive aspect was that it served as a catalyst for certain tools, digital tools. And we realized, just as an example, within a week, we installed cameras and microphones in our office. For years, we had been talking about telemedicine and how we can reach our clients and patients more easily through telemedicine. It was absolutely not possible because data protection issues, because of all kinds of issues. Then the pandemic hit, and within a week, we could install everything. So I think technology and health tech will really revolutionize how we can personalize and reach a bigger part of the population real time.
Thank you. And a great example there with the pandemic and how things really moved. We were pushed to a corner in a nice way, unfortunately, with the pandemic and other consequences. And a truly exciting and very, very dynamic conversation. I really love your insights. We come to the end of the interview. Thank you for accepting my invite. I have one last little question, which I always look for a short answer, which is related to the channel. How can we make healthcare uncomplicated?
Uncomplicated.
Yes.
Whew. And you want like a one sentence answer to that. Or an elevator pitch. Involve the patients. involve the end user. That's actually one of the major stumbling blocks of digital health. So about 80% of all digital health solutions fail to reach the market. If you look at, you know, where it started and the entire development cycle, about 80% fail to reach the market. And one of the major reasons for that is that the end user, and normally that's the provider or ideally the patient, is not involved in the development process. So please, please think about the end user and the patient and build patient-centered solutions. That will help.
Brilliant. Fantastic, Anna. What a great way to round up. Thank you so much again for your amazing contribution, your insights, and the great work that you are doing. We certainly need to bring it all together, technology, people, ideas, innovation, and, of course, more ways to achieve longevity and better health. So thank you so much for being in here with us, Anna.
And João, thank you very much for doing this and being a catalyst and bringing experts and your expertise to the general population. It's really, really inspiring. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Anna. And to all our viewers and listeners, make sure you subscribe to the channel so you get this great content every week. Also, I'm going to post Anna's socials in here, LinkedIn, connect with her, ask about her work, the Longevity Center in Europe and other innovations she's involved with. And make sure you also acknowledge our channel partners, and I'll see you all next time.